Yeah, so this has been looked at, and the nutritionists have recommended diets which are low in these vasoactive amines. However, there does not appear to be an effective nutritional approach to getting a high serotonin down to a normal level.
Maybe a little bit of change, but probably not that significant.
Yeah, a mild amount of change, but probably not significant. So the tumor markers that we have found most appropriate at this point in time are serotonin, as represented by blood tests of serotonin or its breakdown product in the blood of 5-HIAA. We no longer recommend the 24-hour urine 5-HIAA collection because it's difficult, and we have the blood test for 5-HIAA. So the blood test for 5-HIAA or serotonin will give you the handle on how high your serotonin is. And then concerning chromogranin A, that was the gold standard until we realized that many different things affect the chromogranin A level. So it's not sensitive or specific. However, its breakdown product is not affected by these things, such as diet and proton pump inhibitors, which many people with gastritis have to take, and that is called pancreastatin. So we now measure pancreastatin and serotonin or 5-HIAA in the blood as the primary markers for neuroendocrine tumors. And I must tell you that despite all of our colleagues who are knowledgeable knowing about this, these developments in terms of testing, many of them still will do a 24-hour urine collection, which we do not feel is very accurate. And many of them will still do chromogranin A and not pancreastatin. So it takes a while to get people to look at the data on what's most sensitive and specific for neuroendocrine tumors. So the two tests that I would recommend is the blood serotonin level and or the plasma 5-HIAA. And Dr. Ed Wolin and I have an ongoing dialogue on which one we should do, because I've Dr. Warner and I have been doing the blood serotonin levels for many years. And Ed Wolin pointed out that the plasma 5-HIAA is a more stable marker. It doesn't fluctuate as much as serotonin. And it's the breakdown product of serotonin. So he would recommend doing the plasma 5-HIAA. So I've now started to do both.
Mm-hmm. So they're both good.
Absolutely.
Everybody's right.
Absolutely. So this is a great question. It's a very appropriate question because, unfortunately, we've not been able to get labs to standardize it. So each lab has their own range. For example, in our lab, the upper limit of normal of serotonin is about 250. But I have seen labs in which the upper level of the upper level of normal is 450. So what I say is find out your lab's normal range and then track it knowing which lab you're using and try to use the same lab so that you can compare over time what your level is doing. Raising the issue of chromogranin A can be confusing because many patients are on proton pump inhibitor therapy, PPIs, such as omeprazole, Nexium, drugs like that. They all raise chromogranin A very high. So the first thing I would do if I had a patient with an unexplained elevation of chromogranin A is I would do the breakdown product, check the pancreas statin level, and to search for some other cause of an elevated chromogranin A. So the first thing is to do the appropriate markers to see if serotonin is elevated and do something about that, mm-hmm. recognizing that even if your echocardiogram is normal, if you're walking around with an elevated serotonin, you're at risk. Mm-hmm. And so make sure that somebody is focusing on that and trying to get serotonin down to normal. And if you succeed in getting it down to normal, you have essentially prevented carcinoid heart disease. Mm-hmm. So once somebody knows that they have some evidence of scarring of the valves, that's what the lesions are that are caused by serotonin, they should immediately focus on addressing the issue of the high serotonin. Now, that involves, number one, doing something about the amount of tumor that they have secreting serotonin. So sometimes just reducing tumor with surgery and other anti-tumor approaches and medications will be enough to reduce serotonin. The other thing is that there are somatostatin analogs that are given to almost every neuroendocrine tumor patient if they have somatostatin receptors on the tumor, and a large percentage of them do. They should be on a somatostatin analog. And that reduces serotonin also. It helps block the release of this overproduction of serotonin from the tumor cells. It doesn't stop the production of serotonin inside the cell, but it helps block its release. And now, as I mentioned, we have a new drug, which is called Zermelo. That's a tryptophan hydroxylase inhibitor, very targeted at the enzyme involved in the first step in the production of serotonin, which can, in a large percentage of patients, reduce serotonin down to a normal level. And if you achieve a normal level serotonin, you can halt the progression of carcinoid heart disease.
So that's a pretty good development lately, then.
It's incredible. And when I learned that they were developing this drug, I spoke with Lexicon, the company that has produced the drug, and said, my one hope is that you're producing the drug which will put me out of business. So this is an area that our group at Mount Sinai in New York and the group in Jerusalem, Israel, has focused on. And the doctor is astute to raise the issue of fixing a valve and then having a recurrence because he realizes serotonin is still high. This is a very valid issue. It's an important issue. And up until Zermelo was FDA approved, we actually focused on this issue and recommended serious discussion before someone got a valve replaced as to whether you should use a tissue valve, which most neuroendocrine tumor specialists prefer because it doesn't necessarily require long-term anticoagulation, putting them at risk for bleeds if they need surgery. And our recommendation in that situation, after looking at the statistics, was that you seriously consider the use of mechanical valves, which would require anticoagulation, but would prevent the recurrence of the effects of serotonin. Our study showed that there's a 46% recurrence rate shortly after you put in new tissue valves if you don't get serotonin down to normal. Now, initially, when we started doing this type of surgery, the neuroendocrine tumor specialist said, well, we're going to get serotonin down to normal, so go ahead and put tissue valves in. So we presented 29 patients who underwent surgery. Almost all of them got tissue valves. And we showed that there was this 46% recurrence rate, and only one of the patients actually was successful in getting serotonin down to normal. So that's when we published our results and said you should seriously consider mechanical valves. However, now we have Zermelo, and there is nothing as effective as Zermelo for reducing serotonin down to a normal level. And so now we feel we can still go ahead, use tissue valves, but make sure that anyone with an elevated serotonin gets onto Zermelo, along with other tumor reductive procedures, to get serotonin down to normal. If you get serotonin down to normal, you will halt the risk that you're going to have recurrent carcinoid heart disease.